Assalamu alaikum and good afternoon, everyone. I hope I'm audible and visible. And I hope you're all doing well, inshallah. Thank you for taking the time to attend this session. On behalf of Giving Back to Pharmacy in Pakistan team, I would like to invite you all to our session today. So a quick introduction about myself. I'm Kanzarana Ali, the moderator for today. I did a bachelor's in pharmacy from Fatima College of Health Sciences and graduated in July 2020. And just last week, I completed my internship from Tawang Hospital in UAE, Al Ain. This session is organized by Giving Back to Pharmacy in Pakistan, which is an organization of volunteer pharmacists from around the globe working to share knowledge and best practices to improve pharmacy practices in Pakistan. Our vision is empowered pharmacists for better healthcare. Tricks. I'm sure it will be an insightful and beneficial session for all of us who are interested in doing research in the near future, inshallah. Our expert guest speaker for today's session is Professor Saghir Ahmed. He's currently the advisor of academic affairs and head of department at Shifa Tanveer Millat University in Islamabad, Pakistan. Dr. Ahmed studied cardiovascular pharmacology in MPhil for 3 years. Dr. Ahmed has 21 years of teaching, research, and professional experience in the field of neuroscience and pharmacology. Dr. Ahmed's research interest includes pharmacogenetics and personalized medicine. Dr. Ahmed has 51 publications and 9 patents, with H index 14, I 10 index 25, E index 22, and D index 6. Dr. Ahmed is also a reviewer of many international scientific journals. In the list of the most productive scientists by Pakistan Council of Science and Technology, Dr. Ahmed was ranked 2nd in the field of pharmaceutical sciences in Pakistan. Dr. Ahmed is also a member of the British Pharmacological Society, American Society for Pharmacology and Experimental Therapeutics, and International Brain Research Organization in France. It's really an honor to have you with us today. Thank you so much for joining us. And now, without further ado, over to you, Dr. Ahmed.
Thank you very much, Kanza, for the invitation and giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts on research productivity metrics with you guys. So I will start sharing my screen and presentation right away. So, okay, so here's our topic of today, it's the research productivity metrics. And here is a disclosure that I have not received any financial or commercial funding or support for this presentation and no other conflict of interest. So what I expect is that at the end of this session, is at the end of this activity, the participants who are taking part in or watching this webinar, they would be able to understand various research metrics, which are commonly used to measure research productivity. And they should also be able to relate various research productivity metrics with different aspects of research productivity. And finally, I think that my effort would be rewarded properly if I am able to make you understand how to calculate H-index, I-10 index, G-index, and E-index of a research scholar or a research organization or a university. Okay, so why research productivity? Why research productivity is important? Now, for individuals, publication in high impact factor journals has become a major criterion of academic success in the competitive environment of global higher education system. So impact factor is a very important metric of research productivity, and routinely we see, at least in academia, both in public and private sector, and not only in academia, but in other corporate sector as well, it is getting more and more traction. Now, high impact factor publications have very high value. Also appearing in internationally circulated journals published in English is especially prestigious. For universities, why research productivity is important? Now, for universities, at stake is placement in the global university rankings, the allocation of budget from the government, national prestige, the ability to attract the best students and professors, and a preferred place in the pecking order of academia. So all these are advantages of research productivity, and that is why all the countries, universities, research organizations, and scholars, they want to show high productivity, research productivity, which is not only high in quantity, but also in quality. A word or two about research databases. So normally how it works is that we do some research, we write a research paper, and then we publish it in a journal. Now, these journals are indexed in one or more databases. So here are these databases. For example, Google Scholar is a database. It is one of the biggest databases. Although it does not publish the size of Google Scholar's database, third-party researchers estimated it to contain roughly 160 million documents as of May 2014. So it's an old statistic, but at least it shows that it has a huge collection. It has a huge width. An earlier statistical estimate published in PALOS One journal estimated approximately 80 to 90% coverage of all articles published in English, which is a lot. So it means that Google Scholar is a huge database, which has a huge width, but unfortunately it is not one with a very stringent criteria. The criteria of indexing in Google Scholar are not very stringent. So almost every journal can be included in Google Scholar database. On the other hand, PubMed, for example, it has only 27.3 million entries or documents in it, but it has very stringent criteria. And plus it is a database which index only those journals which publish health and medical research. Similarly, Web of Science is another database, very important, has 90 million plus documents, and Scopus is 69 million plus records. Now, here in Pakistan, the Higher Education Commission, it would recognize a journal only if it is indexed in Web of Science or Scopus database, because these indexing in these databases is not easy. For example, in order to index a journal in Web of Science, you need to complete at least 28 different parameters. And if you complete those parameters to their satisfaction only, then you can be indexed in those in the Web of Science database. So this was for these databases. Okay, now we come to the research productivity metrics themselves. One of very frequently used parameters in research productivity is impact factor. You might have heard about the impact factor. So we'll talk about that, what impact factor is, and especially about its limitations. So in any given year, the impact factor of a journal is the average number of citations received per paper published in that journal during two preceding years, which means that, for example, if a journal has an impact factor of 3 in 2008, then its paper published in 2006 and 2007 received 3 citations each on average in 2008. That's how it is defined. Now, if you want to calculate how impact factor is calculated, so this slide will tell you that. For example, the 2008 impact factor of a journal would be calculated as follows. 2008 impact factor equal to A by B, where A is the number of times all the items published in that journal in 2006, and 7 are cited by index publication during 2008. That will be our numerator, the total number of citations in 2008 of which articles, of those articles which are published in that journal in 2006 and 7. So what is B? What is the denominator? Denominator is the total number of citable items published by that journal in 2006 and 7. And you get those articles that are published in 2006 and 7, the number of those articles, that will be denominator. And numerator would be the number of citations of those articles in 2008, okay? So that would, that's how impact factor is calculated. So 2008 impact factor are actually published in 2009. They cannot be calculated by the end of 2008. Publications have been processed by the indexing agencies because they cannot be published in 2008 because you need a whole of an entire year of 2008 in which you need to have all the publication, all the citations, and these citations, the whole year citations can only be calculated once 2008 is completed, after December 31, 2008. And that is why 2008 impact factor is calculated in 2009. For example, currently we have the latest impact factor list is the impact factor list of 2019. So 2020 impact factor list will be out in a couple of months time. So this is an impact factor list. That is the impact factor list of 2017. So you can see some of the journals are very highly cited journals. For example, if you look at the very top, the Cancer Journal for Clinician, it has an impact factor of 244.585. And then the New England Journal of Medicine has also a very high impact factor. Nature and Science, they have impact factor of more than 41. And similarly, this is the latest impact factor file. So the top 16 journals in these in this impact factor list are again a Cancer Journal for Clinicians, followed by the New England Journal of Medicine, and then there are other journals such as Lancet and Journal of American Medical Association. And at the bottom, you can see Nature and Science, which still have very high impact factor, 42 and 41, respectively. Now, unfortunately, in Pakistan, there are about 10 or 11 journals which are indexed in Web of Science, which have some impact factor. But the highest impact factor is 1.17. of Pakistan Journal of Veterinary Sciences. So this is how impact factor is calculated, and these are the latest impact factor rankings. Now, what are the limitations of impact factor? Now, impact factor is not an ideal research productivity or quality metric. And it is important to note that impact factor is a journal metric. It should not be used to assess individual researchers or institutions. We frequently use impact factor as like when we talk about our research, we research scholars and scientists, we usually talk about, we have that much impact factor. I have 50 impact factor. I have 100 impact factor. But this is a misnomer in some sense, because impact factors are not for research as an institution. That is a journal level metric. It tells you the so-called quality of a journal. So this is one limitation. It cannot be used to judge or measure the quality or importance of a research scholar. Then there is a wide variation from article to article within a single journal. For example, about 90% of Nature's 2004 impact factor was based on a quarter of its publication. And thus the importance of any one publication will be different from, and in most cases, less than that number. So which means that, taking again this very example of Nature's 2004 impact factor, it means that about only 10% of the impact factor and citation that are contributed by 75% of publication. So the point here is that even it is a general level metric, even then one should be very cautious, because the impact factor is usually contributed by a very small number of publications. Okay, other limitations of impact factor include that the percentage of total citations occurring in the first 2 years of publication also varies highly among disciplines. For example, in mathematical sciences, it's very low. It's about 1 to 3% in mathematical sciences. In physical sciences, it's slightly higher. And therefore, impact factors cannot be used to compare journals across disciplines, because the citation ratio in the first 2 years is different for different journals. And we frequently see that thing, because like in humanities and social sciences, and even in the hard natural sciences, their impact factors are usually pretty low. Like, for example, if you have 2 or 3 impact factor in medical sciences or pharmaceutical sciences, it is not a very high impact factor. But for people who are working in social sciences, the humanities, this might be their highest impact factor publication or journal. So this is another limitation of impact factors. And we have seen the journal rankings constructed based solely on the impact factor. They usually moderately or poorly correlate with those list compiled from the result of expert surveys. Okay, another problem is the effect of outliers can be seen in one case. That is an article, A Short History of Helix, that was published in a journal, Acta Crystallographica Section A. And that article alone received 6,600 citations. As a consequence, the impact factor of the journal Acta Crystallographica Section A rose from 2.051 in 2008 to 49.926 in 2009, which is actually more than Nature and Science at that time. And then the second most cited article in the same journal had only 28 citations. So this is another flaw, a drawback of impact factors. Outliers can skew the impact factor. Awaaz nahi aa rahi? Can you hear me?
Yes, doctor, we can. Please continue.
Okay. So yeah, another very important problem with impact factor is that journals usually they change their editorial policies, and some journals and their editors, they try to game the whole system. So what they, well, not necessarily in bad faith, but maybe they are doing it unconsciously. But these are some inherent flaws that we are talking about. For example, journals may also attempt to limit the number of citable items, which means that they can reduce the denominator. So like if you reduce the denominator and numerator remains the same, then you will get a higher number, higher impact factor. So this is a very common editorial practice. Another tactic journals employ is to publish a large portion of its research, at least those people that they expect that will be highly cited early in the calendar year. So this gives them more time. This will give publications more time to be cited, which is not a really bad practice. It's not a very questionable practice. But then coercive citation is a practice in which an editor forces an author to do extraneous citations to an article before the journal will agree to publish in order to inflate the journal's impact factor. And a survey published in 2012 indicates that coercive citation has been experienced by 1 in 5 researchers. Now, this is, as you've seen, at least 20% people have experienced that, and that's right. Coercive citation or forceful citation, sometimes editors, what they did, they ask the authors to cite certain papers, and these papers are usually from the same journal. They do that in order to artificially inflate or embellish the importance and impact factor of that journal. So these are some of the editorial policies that editors usually employ in order to game the system, in order to increase the impact factor. Okay, now this was about all about the impact factor and its limitations. And now I must say that impact factor is still a very good metric. I mean, it has several flaws, but still a very good metric. The important thing is that when you are using impact factor metric to measure the quality of a publication or a research profile, so you have to have all these flaws, all these limitations in mind. If you have those limitations in mind, then this is not such a bad research productivity metric. But then impact factor, as I said earlier, it is not a author level metric. So then there was this need of some author level metric, and then came the itch index. So itch index is an author level metric that attempts to measure the productivity and citation impact of the publication of a scientist or a scholar. The definition of the itch index is that a scholar with an itch index has published itch papers, each of which has been cited in other papers at least itch times. Thus, the itch index reflects both the number of publications and the number of citations per publication. I'll give you an example, and probably then you will have a good understanding of this. So for example, if you look at this slide, and on the left-hand side, there is this, I have given the research articles of a scholar, X. So on the left-hand and on the left column are the number of articles, and the right column are the citations. So this profile is arranged in a descending order of number of citations, which means that the article at the very top has the highest number of citations, followed by other articles. And now, what would be the itch index of this scholar? So we can do that, and I tell you how to do that. So first of all, total citations are 229. I have calculated it. Now, its itch index, as I mentioned in the definition in the last slide, is that number, which shows that the scholar has at least that number of citations in each of those publications. For example, in this case, the itch index of this scholar is 9, because 9 of its articles, its articles have at least 9 or more citations. Okay, so once again, the itch index of this scholar is 9, because it's 9 of its articles have at least 9 or more citations. Now, here the itch index could not be 10, because in that case, it would have meant that at least 10 articles of this research scholar has 10 or more citations, which is not the case, because his 8th, 9th, and 10th articles have 9 citations each, not 10. Okay, so the ish index of this scholar would be 9. This was about ish index. Now, there is another index called item index that is created by Google Scholar and using the Google My Citation feature. Item index is the number of publications with at least 10 citations. Now, this is a very simple measure and only used by the Google Scholar, and it is used to help gauge the productivity for scholar. Now, the idea behind item index is that if an article has 10 citations, then it means that this is a good quality article, relatively speaking, good quality article. So I-10 index would be the number of articles of a scholar which have at least 10 citations. So again, in the same example, if you could see that the I-10 index of this scholar is 7, because 7 of his articles have 10 or more citations. Okay, so 7 of his articles are at least, each of these articles have at least 10 citations. So its H index is 9, but his I-10 index is 7. Okay, then there is E index. Okay, now E index actually measures excess citation, which means citations access to H index. Now, this index is complementary to H index. Now these I-10 indexes, especially E index and the last one, G index, these were presented by different scientists and corporations because of the limitations of impact factor, and also because of the limitations of H index, because H index is not without faults. It does not completely describe the citation profile of a researcher or a scientist. And therefore, these other indices have been proposed, which actually address some other aspects of research productivity of a scholar. So, E index, it actually measures excess citation, which means that it measures citations which is lost by H index. And I'll give you an example and then you'll understand. Let me go through this slide. So this index is complementary to H index. And the larger the E index, the larger the net excess citation, and hence more the loss of information when using H index alone. In other words, when H index is used to evaluate individual scientists, the smaller the E index, the more reliable the H index is. In an extreme case, when E index is 0, which is highly likely in reality, then the H index completely describes the citation information for the papers in the H core. Otherwise, when E is not equal to 0, the H index always loses citation information, which is complemented by E index. And in, I'll give you an example of this and then probably it will make sense. Now, again, giving the same example, this scholar has these 13 articles, and on the right hand column shows the number of times these articles have been cited by other documents or other articles. Total number of citations, 2 to 9, H index is 9, I-10 index is 7. What would be E index? So first we are calculating the E index. So as I said, E index is complementary to H index. Now here, if you see the H index of this scholar is 9, okay? But it has a very high number of publication citations compared to like this small number N. It has 229 citation. And if, for example, this person or this scholar had only, say, for example, 9 publications, and each of these publications was cited only 9 times, even then his H index would have been 9. But in that case, his total citation would have been only 81. Okay, but his, so it is possible to have only 81 citations and still have an H index of 9. But here in this case, the total citations are much bigger, much more than 81. So it means that H index is not capturing the complete citing profile of that research scholar. So here comes the E index. E index will measure the excess citation. How it is done? So what you have to do is to look at the H index. H index is 9. So take the square of H index, which is 81. Now you have to subtract that 81 from 229. Okay. So if you subtract 81 from 229, that leaves you with 148. Now you have to take the root of 148, square root of 148, and that gives you number 12 point something. So 12 is the E index of that research scholar. So I'll go through that once again. So E index is calculated by first taking the H index. Here in this case, it is 9, taking the square of it, which is 81. Now subtracting that 81 from 229, that gives you 148, and take a root of a square root of that, which gives you 12.0 something. So 12 is the E index of this scholar. So now 12 is actually much higher than 9, which is H index, which means that actually a lot of its citation is not being captured by H index. So E index is helpful, like if a research manager or departmental head is looking at it, because these indices, these research publications are very important in hiring and promotion. Like a lot depends on these publications and these citations and productivity, research productivity metrics. So if just looking at the H index, it will not give a departmental manager or a researcher or departmental have a very good idea. Along with E index, for example, in this case, this person has E index of 12, will give the departmental head a very good idea of the research profile of that scholar. And finally, G index. The G index is an index for quantifying scientific productivity based on publication record. It is an author level metric, just like H index, E index, I index, I10 index. The G index is an alternative for the older H index, which does not average the number of citations. So G index actually in some ways averages the citation. So it can, in the G index is usually higher than H index because H index does not do averages. And for example, in case of H index, if there are a highly cited article, that will not be counted highly in H index because irrespective of the number of count, like even if it is very high, it will not be counted as much in H index as it will be counted in G index. So I'll show you in the next slide when we'll calculate the G index that how a very highly cited article will contribute a lot towards G index. And in this way, scholars or research scientists, very highly cited article can contribute a lot to its G index, to his G index. So the G index is defined as the highest number of G of papers that together received G square or more citations. The index is calculated such that given a set of articles ranked in decreasing order of the number of citations that they received, the G index is the unique largest number such that the top G articles received together at least G square citations. Now, I tell you what it means. So this is that same exercise, okay? And same research scholar, 229 citations, H index 9, I10 index 7, E index, we just calculated was 12. So what would be the G index? Now, G index would be calculated by in a similar way as we calculated E index, but slightly differently. I mean, again, you have to arrange the publication in a descending order based on the number of citations. Then the G index would be a number, would be that number if you take the total citations of those articles. Like, for example, if I say that 9 is the G index, then I'll have to take the total citations of these 9 articles and add them, and that should be at least equal to the square of 9. Okay, then it would be G index. Say, for example, if I say that this this research scholar has a G index of 9, it would mean that its first 9 papers, if you add their citations, that would be equal or more than the square of 9, which is 81. But if we really add all these publications, these are about close to 200. These are much more than 900. So much more than 81. So the G index is actually more than 9. Here in this case, if we look at the total number of citations, there is 229. And if we take the square root of 229, that would be 15.12 or something. So the G index would be 15 here, which would mean that when I say that the G index of this research scholar is 15, I mean that its first 15 articles, when you combine their citation, that citation is equal or more than the square of 15. So square of 15 is 225, and its total citations are 229. Now you also keep in mind that E index as well as G index, these both of these could not be real numbers. H index and I10 indexes, H index and I10 index, these both of these are real numbers, but E index and G index, they may not be real numbers. Okay, because here in this case, this person's G index is 15, but that person does not have 15 publications. So that could not be real numbers. So this is one of its plans. So anyhow, this was about the G index. And I think that, so this is my profile. You can go to the Google Scholar and you can make your profile. It's free of cost. And then you can look at these profiles and you can calculate E index and E index. Similarly, this is another exercise and you can copy that and you can solve this for H index, I10 index, E index, and G index. So that's it from me. From presentation, I will be very happy to answer questions about research, productivity, all of these things. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed, for such an insightful presentation. The information was amazingly put together and easy to follow. We definitely learned a lot, and we have a couple of questions from our audience. Firstly, how can pharmacist community in Pakistan help improve the local medical journals and pharmacy journals in Pakistan?
Can you repeat it? Sorry, I couldn't hear it.
Okay. How can pharmacy community in Pakistan help improve the local medical journals and pharmacy journals in Pakistan?
Okay, so it's a very good question, I think. The quality of research journals is enhanced by the quality of research that is published in that journal. So at the end of the day, what matters is quality. If your data is very good, and more importantly, if the so one of the biggest problem that I see in reviewing articles for various journals is the study designs. So many studies, they are actually we can see that a lot of effort has people have put a lot of effort into getting out research and all those things, but in many cases the study designs are not pertinent or relevant or not suitable for the kind of question they are asking. So I would say that the quality of research journals can be enhanced by enhancing the research that is published in those journals. And for that, we need to do quality research. And not on, and by quality research, I not only mean that we should look at these objective measures that I have just talked about, but also look at the relevance at the national and local level. So if we address questions that are relevant at the local level in Pakistan at the national level, then I think that will also enhance the quality of research journals.
Thank you very much. Second question, how can pharmacy students engage in research activities early in the college career?
Yeah, I think that is very important. That is very, very important. You see, so I often, when I talk to the students, and I often say that like a difference between a college and university is that in a simple college, knowledge is only disseminated, whereas university is a place where knowledge is also created, not only disseminated. And by creating knowledge, I mean doing research. In all good universities, research starts at the undergrad level. And at many great universities, it is actually compulsory to do research. Here in many universities in Pakistan, including our university, I especially do offer, and a lot of other people also do that, they offer summer research electives, in which student, undergrad students, they come, they not only learn how to do research, they gain a very useful technical information as well. So I think that it is very important for students, PharmD students, to engage in research at during their studies. I understand that here in Pakistan, especially, students have to study like about 200 credit hours in 5 years. That is a lot. That is really a lot. I understand that. That's a lot of study, no doubt about it. But still, I would encourage students to engage in research, because these days you cannot live without research. It is an era of continuous professional education. So you need to do a lot of research. And not only that, it will help you in all walks of life. The research skills, the analytical and logical skills that you gain by doing research will really help you in other areas of life as well. So I would strongly encourage students in Pakistan, especially, to engage in research, in meaningful research at undergrad levels, especially during the summer vacations.
Thank you very much. We just had two questions. Before we end the session, I would like to remind the participants to complete the feedback form to avail the certificate of attendance. The link to the form is provided in the chat section below. And this brings us to the end of our session today. Once again, on behalf of Giving Back to Pharmacy in Pakistan team, I would like to thank Dr. Ahmed for taking the time to share your expertise with us, for your valuable input, and for shedding light on such an important topic. Thank you as well to all the attendees for sticking by and participating actively in the question answer session. And finally, thank you, Dr. Siddiqui, for giving me the opportunity to moderate today's session. Stay tuned for our next session, Medications in Ramadan, on April 10th, where we'll invite expert panel to discuss about the topic. And